tourism did come to pass. It took place in Columbus, Ohio, at the State University there, where Morgan Frager has been invited to give a master class. And when I have found out about his coming, I have traveled from where I was teaching at the time at the University of Dayton. And I heard Malcolm's master class, and I was very pleasantly surprised, because Malcolm was dealing a great deal in his teaching with something which I have, since a teenager, been always been busy doing, namely finding thematic connections in various works. It was very interesting that to many of the students who performed, Malcolm asked them questions of what do they really want to do with this piece, how do they see the performance. He didn't tell them what to do, he first asked them how do they want to play the piece, and then of course he asked them why do you want to play that piece that way, and in this sense then he gradually got to the idea of thematic connections. Well, after the masterclass was over, I went to Malcolm and introduced myself, and he was very kind, he spent an awful lot of time with me afterwards. And when I was so emboldened by his demeanor towards me, I told him, you know, I'm very fascinated by what you've said about thematic connections, because I have long now been doing this very same thing, and among others, I have found something that might interest you, namely I believe that we have not been playing the Mozart Fantasy in C minor the way Mozart wanted us to play it. And I showed him why I thought this was the case. Now, Malcolm was very quick. It didn't take me a lot to tell him, for him to react right away to this idea. And he told me, my God, you have to make sure you let people know about this. And it's only been not too long ago, in last year, that I have published what I consider now the explicit notation of the voice leading to Mozart's Fantasy in C minor, which you will find on the handout. I don't know if you can see there, but don't worry about it if you cannot. It's on the bottom of page one of the handout. I would like to go to the piano now and give you a little bit of an idea what this is all about. You have heard yesterday a wonderful presentation by Robert Levin, where he gave you also an improvisation. He was given a theme from the audience, and then he went to the piano and developed these themes into compositions. And he made a very interesting remark. He said that we think of Mozart today as a composer, but in the first place he was an improviser, and only later on down the line he was also a composer. Well, what I'm trying to say to you today, and this is the things we discussed with Malcolm, is that actually the improvisation of music and the composition of a piece of music abides by the same laws. And this law is a very simple thing. What Robert Levin did yesterday is basically exactly the way a composer works. A composer, at the beginning, takes a very small number of musical ideas. Let's call these ideas now the seed of the composition. And then, out of this seed, the whole improvisation takes forth. This is exactly the idea of a great composer too. Because a great composer does not always bring new ideas. What a great composer does is a great composer limits himself or herself to a very few ideas and then develops these ideas in a variational form. Let's take a look at what this sounds like in real practice. You probably all know Beethoven's Waldstein Sonata. Now, when it comes to great composers, in the case of Beethoven, as you heard, everything is very obvious. There is, however, one composer who is what the Germans say raffiniert. I should say that as refined. Well, refined and subtle is the right word. Subtle. With Mozart, Mozart has never been known as a composer for whom this thematic transformation is an important thing. But why? Because I think, in this respect, Mozart is the greatest. His imagination in varying the seed material is so great that you don't even notice it. You truly feel all the time he's bringing you something completely new which is not related to what you have heard before. And it took me, as in the case of this piece, of course, a great deal of time to discover this. But how did I come upon it? Well, I took this idea seriously, that if it's a good work, it ought to come from the same idea. So I started working on the fantasy in C minor. Idea, if a composition is a growth out of the seed, maybe I ought to start not with the first four measures of the piece, but with the last four measures of the piece. What did I find? What does Mozart do in the last measure? Thank you. single one that was done in Mozart's style. One could say about this piece, 200 years of terrible cadenzas of the flats in C minor. Well, what did Mozart exactly have in mind? Mozart had in mind the Baroque effect, the four descending notes, which appear also in his sonata in C minor, which Mozart decided to publish together with a fantasy. Mozart believed that these two pieces are related. Now I know they are related. funnels about continuo, performing continuo in Mozart, Haydn, and Beethoven's piano concerti, which Morton was one of the pioneer pianists to do. As a conclusion to my presentation here, I'd like to read to you just a couple of sentences. Precisely through restricting oneself to varying the seed idea, the composer gains the greatest possible freedom. By constant reference to a genetic code, even large-scale compositions can be unified into one organic whole. Only a perfect balance between the two basic aspects of music, repetition and variation, can bestow upon the listener the highest musical experience. On the one hand, repetition of the genetic code affords the listener a subconscious perception of unity. But this unity never turns into boredom, because upon the background of changelessness, the listener consciously perceives the composition's ever-varying foreground. A foreground of change projected against a background of changelessness. This is the manifestation of genius in music. And among the great geniuses of music, Mozart stands alone. In Mozart's music, that which does not change and that which is subject to change seem to coexist in an effortless unity. One can truly say that in Mozart's music, eternity is experienced in the delight of the passing moment. But let this apparent effortlessness not seduce you into thinking that correlating Mozart's ever-new variations to their changeless core is an effortless task for the rest of us.